Good evening. I'm Dr. Gina McKenzie, host of the Philadelphia Cultural Forum on CCP-TV, the educational channel of the Community College of Philadelphia. Tonight we have with us Chris Fieri, chair of the art department at Community College of Philadelphia, and Terry Peterson, an instructor in the art department. Terry's going to share with us tonight his book arts and some of his most unique work. So stay tuned for a great interview.
My name's Chris Feiro, and I'm the department chair of the art department here at the Community College of Philadelphia. Today we have with us Terry Peterson. Terry's been teaching at the college for 10 years. He recently returned from a leave of absence taken to complete the MFA program in book arts at the University of the Arts. Terry graduated from CCP, and after his studies at CCP, attended the Rhode Island School of Design, where he studied graphic design. Terry spent several years working professionally as a graphic designer before joining the faculty in the art department at CCP. His experience as a graphic designer helped to solidify his interest in book arts. So Terry, to begin with, could you define book arts for us?
I could start by telling you what book arts is not. Book arts is not your typical mass-produced book that you would see in a bookstore. With pages and with content and narrative, as we know books to be. Mm-hmm. Book artists work within those realms or within those conventions of books, where we might create something that's a handmade book or something that's a hand-sewn book or something along those lines. But in the realm of book arts, books can also fall into the category of the highly structured or highly sculptural book.
Okay.
For instance, here, this is a book where the structure of the book, the size, the casing of the book, and the content are working in tandem with one another. So what's inside of the book has something to do with what's on the outside of the book. And in this sense, the book becomes a book object. And the form of the book becomes a container for the idea. And there are times when your idea could actually come in the format of an installation. Where you're asking your audience to experience or be in your space that you have your book displayed and experience the narrative. And in this way, it becomes more of an experiential format. But whichever format a book artist works in, it's always with the idea of conveying a story in a way that is greater than the conventions of a normal book. So people who are book artists are people who not only create books, but we create art. And we find artful ways of being able to tell a story.
Okay. Terry, how did your interest in book arts develop?
When I was a student here at CCP many years ago, I had a three-dimensional design teacher named Mei Ling Hom. Mm-hmm. And this is where my interest in book binding began. Each week she would have us write a journal, create a handmade journal, and we would hand bind it, and this is actually one of the journals. We would write whatever we had about that particular topic of that week, and we would hand sew it in what at the time I called a pretzel stitch because it was kind of an easy stitch to create, but I've since known that it's called a pamphlet stitch. And I really liked doing these journals each week. There were about 14 of them by the end of the semester. So when I did finally transfer to the Rhode Island School of Design, I started becoming interested in bookbinding and started to take more of the bookbinding type classes that were in my mm-hmm. curriculum and outside of my curriculum as an elective. And then wanted to work more with content and how content and the form of the book came together. Mm-hmm. Worked as a graphic designer and worked in publishing for several years, so I worked with a lot of books, and finally wanted to go into a little bit more of the book arts and decided to go into the graduate program at the University of the Arts for book arts, just to take the ideas a little bit further.
Terry, I noticed that you have some examples of your work here today. Can you show us some of these examples and then maybe describe to us a little bit about the materials and the process?
Sure. Okay, I can start with these papers. These are called paste papers, and they're papers that are decoratively or made decoratively by hand. They're just a regular cardstock, or it can be any kind of substrate you want to start with. but the texture and the pattern and the colors that you use are all something that you can take a toothpick or take some other kind of device and really start to create designs in. It's a pigment. It's also a paste that you're working with, a mixture of paste. And you're able to create some very bold designs and some very intricate, very specific designs. And eventually, you can utilize these papers to make book covers. So this is one that I showed earlier. So although it's a bold print when you're doing it in the large format, you can start to scale it down by utilizing it in a book cover. So each one of these were done with paste papers. So it turns out that if you can't find a decorative paper at your art supply store, you can make your own. You can make your own papers. This is marbleized papers. So again, these are done with color, and the color is suspended in water, and it's offset onto your paper when you place the paper on top of it.
And so is this printed onto the paper?
It's offset on the onto the paper. So you have a blank piece of paper at first, and you have a shallow dish of water mm-hmm. that you've put a mixture of paste in the water to make it a little thicker. And as you drop your pigment on top and kind of create a design or swirl it around, the pigment stays on the top and doesn't go below the surface. And it's suspended on the top of the surface, and you put your paper on top, and it offsets onto the paper. It's a great process to work in. It's great to kind of see your ideas coming to life in the water and then also on the paper as a result. So these are other examples of the marbleized paper technique and how it can be used on your papers just to create decorative usage for your ideas, for your book covers. These are also another idea. And these are some old prints that I did, one that I did and one that a former student of ours did. And I like this print. It was a four-color print, but I also found that I could use it for another purpose. So eventually I cut some of them up and made book covers out of them with, you know, this simple pamphlet stitch and craft paper on the inside. This is one of our former students made this mono print, which is just one single print, working with letterpress and working with inks and working with different acrylic paints. And I use that to create these book covers with.
So you're able to reuse a lot of materials that you have maybe lying around the studio.
I have flat file drawers with all kinds of scrap material, and you know, each time I go to an art supply store or a craft store, you pick up different pieces, not ever knowing necessarily how you're going to use them, but you can find a use for them eventually. Here's another letterpress print, and I think I made about 100 of these, maybe 150. And later utilized it for some of these small books. And this is, I'm gonna show you what a case-bound book would actually start off as. We take these folded pages that we call signatures, each of these individual sections, and you use this linen tape, and we use the process of going in and out of each one of the pages and then down to the next signature and tying it both to the tapes themselves, but then also tying the signatures to each other so that they become one cohesive book block is what it's called.
So this is a very strong binding then?
It's very strong, and you also will do the process of putting the covers on top of it. So this book will eventually look like this one.
Okay.
They were done exactly the same way. But then working with the hard covers and working with securing the spine of the book with a lot of protective covering on the inside, you end up with a very sturdy book. And this is considered a case-bound book, a hard case cover book, that began like this. So, in fact, I'm still working on this. I still have the needle that I'm actually adding more signatures to it. This is what's called a Coptic stitch. And Coptic stitch is an old Egyptian form of binding, which is more of an exposed binding. And you know, I have a couple of examples here. And you know, these two have wooden covers. So you know, whenever I'm at Home Depot, I always try to get some spare wood or scrap pieces of wood so that I can use them for covers for books that I'll do later. This is kind of an expansion on an accordion fold book. This accordion that's on the spine here, this portion, opens up and becomes this expandable album. You can utilize this for photographs or for telling an episodic story, you know, where you have, you know, each one of the booklets is one contained story. And each one of these booklets are attached to this spine, this accordion folded spine. And these are some traditional Japanese bound books in this wrap that contains them all. So each one has a different kind of stitch to it. This is also called a stab binding, where you're taking your covers and your text block or the interior papers, and you're punching holes in them and creating this pattern for holding the books together. It also helps sometimes to have a sample card before starting each one of your stitching. So these are called sewing cards. So it gives you a little sample of what the process is for doing each one of the stitches. But then it also has the hole pattern at the bottom that you would follow when you are punching the holes in each one of them.
Okay.
So it kind of gives you a sample of what the idea is going to end up being, what the binding is going to end up being, but then it also gives you the pattern that you can start with.
Terry, most of what you've shown us have been fairly traditional, I guess, bindings of books. But I also noticed that you have something here that looks like almost a file cabinet.
Yes, this is actually a book, or I call it a book. And this is it was part of my thesis, a component of my thesis at the University of the Arts. And this is a story of a family of four, the mother, the father, and the son and the daughter. And if you read through, I can pull out this first drawer here. Each one of these drawers have sectioned off areas that the main character of the story, who is named Judy, and she's the mother, has collected all of these mementos and, you know, different artifacts to talk about the life of her children, she and her children. So this is her drawer. It has different things from the gloves from her wedding, the doorknob from her first home, sunglasses that she might have worn in the 60s, and other little things that give you clues as to who each one of the characters are. So the more you look through the box and the more you read through the correspondences, there are letters and greeting cards and other pieces that are underneath here, the better you're able to understand who the family was. And there's also a little newspaper article that accompanies it that talks about a more recent incident that happened that involved the family and also may have contributed into certain dynamics of the family currently. This would have been the drawer that she kept for her oldest son. Anything from his pacifier to little gloves and saddle shoes and other tassel from graduation and so on. So this is what I was speaking of earlier about a book becoming more of a book object, and this being the container for the actual story. This is another one. I'll only show a portion of this, but this is a book form called In Reasonable Privacy, and it's done in the format of a changing screen. And it talks about issues of privacy. And it's done with handmade paper, and the paper has letters that are ripped up. So as you start reading through the different passages of the text that's on the cover of the paper and start to look at some of the images on the opposite side, you start to get a sense of an invasion of privacy. Mm-hmm. The back cover has this zipper that you're able to open up, and there's a little message on the inside. So you'd actually have to go into the pant to actually retrieve the message.
Terry, back to your thesis piece from graduate school. Can you talk about maybe how that idea developed, where the idea came from?
The idea for this actual piece, and in fact I can show you one of them right here, was a matchbook. I collect matchbooks, and I have a series of these wedding matchbooks that friends have given to me over the years, and this one was actually Jim and Judy, who were married in June of 1964. So I've often wondered who these people were and what their lives were about. So I took four of these matchbooks from various people and put them together as a family and wrote a backstory about who these individuals are. The dates of the story have a lot to do with the influence of the story. Mm-hmm. Jim and Judy are a couple in the 60s. There was a lot going on in the 60s. So I used some of the then current events in the 60s to incorporate it into the story. So your ideas can come from many places. Or I've tried to I try to write as I'm going on my travels. I try to conjure up ideas. I listen to quotes and conversations between people, and any number of things can inspire you for ideas. This is actually a book from, let's see if I can turn it this way, that was inspired by a poem by Thomas Hardy called The Ruined Maid, that I remember reading here at Community College in my English 101 class. And it's about two sisters who started off in the same area, and as they got older, they grew apart. And one moved to the city, the other stayed in the country, and the story takes place after several years when they come back together. And the conversation between the two of them. So instead of images, I'm using text. And this was all done on a letterpress, so the letters were set by hand. And it's a dialogue between the two sisters, so there's a nice back and forth that happens. So I wanted to bind the book so that it had that same kind of back and forth quality to it. One side is a little more decorative, one side is a little more plain. They're bound in two different directions because they've come from two different directions. So again, this is another idea where the form of the book and what's inside of the book are playing along with one another. This is also a book that has no words at all. This actually translates into, it's A la poursuite de la vis, and it loosely translates into Chasing the Screw. And this is a book where I used a straight pin and a screw, and one is following the other, and it's all about that kind of relentless pursuit of relationship. Mm-hmm. And the pin eventually falls in love with the screw. So, and this is just using balsa wood, basswood, and creating a little set that that these objects are placed in and photographed. So again, inspiration. I look back at black and white design, you know, when we're looking at positive and negative shape and spacing and black and white images, photography, so all of those things come into play. I can show you one more book. This is a clamshell box with a case-bound book on the inside. Again, this was done very similar to the first book that I showed. That's hand-sewn on the spine, decorative papers. So you start to see the process of pulling all of these things together and synthesizing them into book objects. And here's another one. And I like using the wire-bound book because it opens very flat and has lots of very practical usages. This could be a photo album, could be used as a photo album or some type of scrapbook of sorts, and fits neatly within this box. An important factor or important thing to factor into all of these books is how well you measure, you know, and how well you know the ruler, because, you know, in this particular case, I have to make the book first and then build the box around the book, you know, so in order for it to fit as snug as it does, you have to be really good with measuring and understanding the ruler and understanding how to cut and work with materials the right way.
Can you maybe talk a little bit more about craftsmanship that goes into the books, tools that are needed just in general and for bookmaking?
Right. For bookbinding, you usually, and I could show some of the supplies that I've had. I kind of carry these around. These are some general supplies that you would use in bookbinding. So you would have your bone folders, rulers, scissors, X-Acto knives. Of course, threads and cords that you're using, needles, hole punches, and all of these come together in being able to craft and bind a book. Mm-hmm. And even as craft is very important, there are books that you can create that aren't seemingly well crafted, that still have a general idea of what the form and the content actually are. Maybe it's a book that's not meant to be crafted well.
Okay.
But these are some of the supplies that you would use, and they're very basic supplies that you would use for binding.
Okay. Terry, can you talk about how your experience here at CCP has influenced you as an artist?
Well, since I was a student here, every class that I took has paid off in many ways. Mm-hmm. I've carried it over to RISD when I went there. I utilize everything that I've learned in my work and have utilized everything as a graphic designer. You know, we're working in our department, we're working with three-dimensional objects, we're working with black and white design and color and all of those formal elements or those mother skills that we need as an artist that I've used in every one of these books and have never forgotten it. And I'm also around a great deal of extremely talented students and faculty members that I highly admire and who are always showing work and who are very professional. And you know, so I learn a lot from those experiences as well. Mm-hmm. Anything from your English class, you know, I do a lot of writing, working with math and measurements, you know, all of those things come into play. So they're not skills that you are just picking up and forgetting about. You know, you utilize them all throughout your career as an artist, and I've done so.
Well, thank you, Terry, for sharing your work with us today.
Oh, thank you, Chris.
And we appreciate you taking time to describe to us what book arts are. Terry's just one of the many talented working artists that we have as faculty here in the art department at CCP. If you'd like to learn more about our department and the courses that we offer, you can visit our website at www.ccpart.org.